Well, hey, good morning, Stonewater. How are we doing today? So good. Hey, today is going to be so special. I'm so excited for today and all that is going to happen. This morning, we're actually going to teach you guys a new song. But also, I'm going to ask you to do something I've never asked you to do before. So I want you to think back. As long as you've gone to this church, I've never asked you to do what I'm about to ask you to do. Our bodies were created as instruments. So we sing naturally. If you don't know how to sing, if you just talk slow, it makes you sing. So if you talk slow, you sing. You can also play the drums with your body. It's so simple. It's just this. That's it. That's all you do. And the Bible actually says, clap your hands, all the earth. All ye people, clap your hands in celebration of the Lord. So if you were here last week, I said, hey, this is how we celebrate. Clapping is a celebration. Think about a football game where somebody scores a touchdown. We throw our hands in the air and then we clap. We celebrate. Celebrating is a part of praise, is a part of worship. And so this morning, I'm going to ask you to clap with me. Okay? And what you need to know about clapping in a song is it's not a race. If you clap before the person next to you, you don't win. In fact, you lose. You've lost the clapping game. And it's so simple. It's just like this. And so you're going to hear one of these instruments. It's Justin. I don't know why I said that. You're going to hear Justin in a minute. He's going to kick in, and you're just going to follow and clap what he does to this song that we're going to sing. It's so simple. I want to teach it to you. Here you go. You picked me up. You turned me around. You placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you heal my heart, you change my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior. Let's sing it again. You picked me up, you turned me around, you placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you heal my heart, you change my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God. You guys sound great. I'm gonna ask you to stand to your feet. Here we go. Just like this. It's that. Remember, it's not a race. All right, now we sing. Here we go. Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this bag of bones. And I try with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a bag of mine. Just when I ran out of the road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I was not alone. You know this part. You picked me up, you turned me around, you placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you healed my heart, you changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God. All right, if you're tired of clapping, you don't have to clap anymore during the verse. Here we go. I cannot deny what I've seen. Got no choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friend, burning and bitterness. You can't just keep it moving. Now you ain't welcome here. From now till I walk the streets of gold, I sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back home. That's why we clap this morning, church.
Hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. You picked me up. You turned me around. You placed my feet on solid ground. I ain't the master. I ain't the savior. You healed my heart.
What a way to start. Hey guys, don't have a seat. So if you just stand up, I'm going to interrupt you for just a few seconds and then we're going to continue to jam. My name is Casey and I just want to say a special welcome to a few people who are here. Those are those who, maybe this is your first time, maybe you're new here, maybe you're like, hey, I've been coming, but I just feel like I'm new and I want to get connected. I want to find out more about this place. I want to encourage you. We're just honored that you would spend your morning with us today. We have a connection center, a room right outside in the main hall, where a team of people would love to introduce themselves, meet you, answer any questions we have. We also have this little QR code, this little connection card in the seat back in front of you. Great way to find out all kinds of information about our church. We're going to continue to worship. I'm going to encourage you guys, just knuckle bump somebody next to you right now and say, I'm glad you're here.
Incredible. So hey, this morning I got here and I was like, hey, I came up with one more song that I think would be fun to play underneath a pastor praying or something. If you haven't heard me talk about this, I like to play songs that everybody knows while the pastor's praying. So I think. Just a little Disney. So just think the next time the preacher's praying and I'm playing, I could be playing part of your world while he's praying. It'll be fun. Hey, we're going to keep singing out. And this next song is just all about declaring the greatness of our God. It's a weird transition to go from Disney to like the greatness of the Lord. So apologize. I wasn't supposed to do that. But this song says, hey, God, this is what you have done for us. And then this is our response, that we would sing, great are you, Lord. There's no one like you. So as we sing together this morning, I pray that that our hearts and our minds would just focus on him while we sing out these words. And try to steal your minds, steal your hearts from whatever's been going on this morning. Just try to focus solely on him today. Here we go.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
Sing that again. You give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you
. Let's declare this together, all the earth.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout. Great are you, Lord.
you so much for this special time we get to spend with each and every one of these people, and we get to be unified to worship you, God. You are the King over all of our hearts, and Lord, I pray that we find identity in you today and nothing else, just you, God. Just open up our hearts to hear. Amen. Y'all can be seated.
Good morning, Stillwater and Granbury. Hey, we are in week three, because last week we took a break because Dan was here, but it's technically week four of our series called Real Stories of Real Faith, and we've been having different preachers preach each week, and this week our speaker is Kevin Cobb, okay? You're going to love Kevin. Kevin serves on our advisory/elder board, and Kevin has been, we started a friendship years ago when Kevin started visiting Stillwater with his wife, Whitney. And Kevin and I went out to eat, and found out he's former NFL football player, and he's a business owner. He's done a lot of things, but here's where I really connected with Kevin, is Kevin has a real desire to grow deep in his relationship with the Lord. Like Kevin and I started meeting, and I was actually coaching him in his walk with the Lord, and he would come in, and as I would share things about the Lord, he would take notes. And then he would go home and he would teach them to his wife. And I didn't even tell him to do that. He just did that. And I just thought that was an incredible way of being a spiritual leader in his family. Over the years, I've seen God just grow Kevin in just some tremendous ways. And one of the ways is through his speaking. So today, you're in for a treat. I'm not gonna blow the secret, but you're in for a treat for what he's gonna share today. So if you would, put your seatbelt on and get ready for your speaker today, Kevin Cobb.
I have to redeem my name. I have to redeem my name. Cobb, you don't understand. You don't know what it's like to be here. You don't know what it's like to go through this when everything's coming down on top of you. I have to redeem my name. I know you keep telling me that I'm redeemed, but I don't believe it. You don't know what it's like, Cobb. You don't know what it's like for everybody to be chanting your name in all the wrong directions. It's dark right here. You probably know his name. There's two seats up here. But I guarantee you don't know his story. We're about to hear it.
Football back to respectability. He then faced a similar challenge when arriving at Baylor in 2008, taking over a program that had been unranked for 22 years.
There's a purpose in life, and the purpose is to live here for after.
Bryles mentors and serves as a surrogate father to student athletes who face struggles from being parentless.
When times are despondent, you find a reason to make it positive, because it's bad, it's things on that. Stay back. So look for opportunities to change and make it better. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You know, I mean, when you need strength, you know, Christ is where you look.
It was 1998, and I'm at Decatur Middle School, and a friend of mine asked me if I want to go watch a high school playoff game. Of course I do. Second or third round of the playoffs. It's Stephenville High School versus South Lake Carroll at Cowboys Stadium. He had a cousin that was a janitor there. He snuck us in the back when you could do that. And we ended up coming out of the tunnel, and we're on the Stephenville side. And the helmets there, the smoke, the canned fans, if you've ever been to a Stephenville game, extremely loud, crazy. And humbly sitting behind everybody is this man. And I somehow find myself like 20 feet from him. And I'm like, that is Art Briles. That is Art Briles. Fast forward to the next morning, I get home late that night, and my parents wake up and ask me, how was it? And I said, we need to move to Stephenville, Texas. I've never seen football like that in my life. Coach, do you remember the game?
Yeah, I do. Who was standing next to me in the tunnel?
Kellen Luker. Is the first time in my life.
What you were saying is, there's Kellen Luker.
No, I wasn't. I was saying, there's Art Briles and Kellen Luker, and there's Stephenville, Texas. The interesting thing was, at that time, you had to be 6'4", 6'5". You had to look like Drew Bledsoe in order to play college ball. And my dad's 5'10 and a half. My mom's 5'6". I didn't have a prayer to get over 6 foot. And this is the first man that said, I saw Kellen.
Yeah.
And then I saw your son, who's short. And I thought, man, this guy believes that I can play college football. And he's the first one that taught me that, hey, it's not about your height, it's about your heart. And we moved to Stephenville, and I began to learn the game of football underneath Art Briles. How many state championships?
I don't know. That's all irrelevant, honestly. I will tell you about that game, though, Kyle.
Okay, tell me about the game.
Because it was kind of very interesting. It was South Lake Carroll team. They were 13-0. And let's see, that was 98.
Yep.
Yeah, so we were 12-1, actually. We'd lost to Brownwood in district.
Yep.
But they were really, really talented. Just a dominant football team that was moved up to 5A the next year. They were old 4A then, you know, and they were going to go to 5A. So they were really good. But they had us down 2 points late in the game, like with 2.5 left. Had the ball on our 23. Could have kicked a field goal. They were 4th-and-2 on the left hash. Could have kicked a field goal. Decided not to. Tried to ice the game, handing it to their running back, who was, I think his name was Christian, a really good player. And we actually, you know, a guy named Jeff Smith made the tackle in the backfield, and we stopped him. So we got no timeouts. We got about, 75 yards to go. Kind of knew that they would be aggressive defensively because their head coach was a defensive guy. So we threw the middle screen to Cardwell, picked up about 20. And then they backed off after that, went to a cover three look, threw the check down to KC Steed on the right side, and then we're, you know, first down on their 45 with 20-something seconds left, and then we figured he'd pressure again. Pressures.
Cover zero?
Got Cody Cardwell, man on man, and, of course, Luker, to Cobb mentioned, he can spin it. So he threw a dime to him. We ended up winning the game and then actually won the next week. But it was a great win. He saw a really good football game that day.
It was. There was a lot of good football games. Can you believe he can remember all that? What in the world?
Also, is J. Matt White here? Somebody told me he was going to be here. J. Matt, are you here? He's probably sleeping in coming the next summer.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, so he did catch a touchdown pass for us against Belton in 1991.
But this is true coach talk, right? Can you believe this man can remember all these things? We could go on and on and on about all the things that happened at Stephenville, which is really where you became one of the most innovative minds of all, and I'm going to say it, he won't, but one of the most innovative minds of all time in football, period, worldwide. I can say that because the man that declared that was a man named Andy Reid, who I played for years later. And I think we would all agree he's a pretty darn good coach. And he thinks that this guy is that good. It started in Stephenville. Well, it probably started before that, but Stephenville's really where it started to gain momentum and gain form. If y'all remember whenever Patrick Mahomes did the behind the back to Travis Kelce a couple years ago near the goal line and everybody was ranting and raving about it, I took a 1994 clip and I sent it to Andy, and it was of Art teaching his quarterbacks that in the green room at Stephenville. And I said, man, you're like 15 years behind. What are you doing, Andy? And his only response was, great minds think alike, Cobb. And he's exactly right. So Coach goes on to do amazing things in Stephenville. I moved to Stephenville, and he takes the job at Texas Tech as the running backs coach. I'm assuming that has to do with you've done a lot at the high school level and you want to see. At this point, there's talk because we're kind of gimmicky, right? You've heard that word before.
Oh, yeah.
Probably pisses you off, but we've heard. Okay.
I'm good with it.
Okay. And as a competitor, you want to see if you can make it to college ranks. They say, no, you're not going to be able to. It's not going to transpire. It's not going to go to the next level. And so I'm assuming that's why you made that jump or decided to make that jump.
Yeah, really a couple of reasons. You know, first of all, if you're a competitor, if you're in a sport, a business, whatever you're in, you want to feel challenged, you know. And we felt like we'd kind of crossed all the bridges that we could cross at Stephenville at that time. And I really wanted the community to be very aggressive and progressive. And they decided to build a new junior high and not a new high school. And I felt like at that time, you know, with what we had had going over about, the last six-year period, that if they built a new high school, it could be like Aledo is now. You know, it could be a South Lake Carroll. It could be something where people would really move in there and grow with it. But that, you know, that wasn't the vision. So I had the opportunity to go to Texas Tech with Coach Leach and, you know, a lot of other really, really good football coaches. And, you know, just kind of start over. I felt like I'd give it 5 years. If it didn't work, then I'd, you know, come back and be a high school coach again, because I'd already been one for 21 years at that time.
So he goes to Tech. He tries to recruit me to Tech. I'm not sure if y'all have been around Leach very much, but he's a little bit of an awkward human being, I'm going to Oklahoma State. He then gets the University of Houston job my senior year with about 2 months left before signing date, and I must really love this man because he drug me to the inner city of Houston. And what was Houston's record before we got there?
Well, what times zero is always zero.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, it's
0-12.
Yeah.
0-12, there wasn't a person in the stands. We get there and we're like, what are we doing? We had to fight for everything that we had. Mm-hmm. But really, this is where our relationship grew. This is where I already believed in him. I already trusted him. You don't have to trust him yet. I want to put that out there. Trust me that I brought a humble man that's going to tell a humble story and just sit back. Give us grace. We're not pastors. We're guest speakers today, okay? So we need your grace and compassion. If you do have an opinion, amen, you're welcome to it. But let's just hear us out today. So we get to Houston, and I've probably never even told you this, but there was something about us building that program together that you allowed me in to your leadership role. You would tell me things, and you would, I just remember, like, there was authority that I had ownership in the program. And it helps me today, not only in ministry, not only in business, not only in my family, but like I didn't belong there. I was just a kid.
Well,
but you trusted me.
Let me tell you why, Cobb.
Okay.
First reason is that when I was on the sideline and we'd call a play and you'd come to the sideline and we would see something and I'd ask you, I said, Cobb, what'd you see? And you'd say, well, coach, the safety was low, the backside corner was high, you know, they're bringing the backer off the weak side. And, you know, then the play would work. And then when we get and watch video, it'd be exactly, you know, what you said on the field. So I'm thinking, this guy knows what he's talking about. So, like I always told players in coaching, if you want to have leadership, produce. You know, if you want somebody to listen to you, be productive. You know, be good at what you're doing, and then you'll have an opportunity to be a leader. But that was the main reason, plus knowing you and knowing your family. You know, you had an inside there to begin with me and Montgomery and Clements, mm-hmm, and,
right,
and all the guys that you were comfortable with, you know, and Kendall coming over. So it was a really good family atmosphere and a great time to grow together, you know, as a staff and as a player and as a program.
Yeah, and really this is where it went from player coach, in my opinion, to family. And Kendall, his son, was my best friend, and I got to be around their family a lot. And so this is where our relationship really went beyond the field. And we went on, by God's grace, sincerely, it was an amazing story. And one of the best games was, what we'll get to later, which was at SMU. And we sealed the deal with the conference championship back at home. Houston's not the Houston you see today. They were trying to do away with the program. They were trying to defund us, all this stuff. And we brought the championship home for the first time in, I don't know, a long time. And we sold the stadium out, which was almost as big a deal as anything because you're competing against the Houston crowd. It's really hard to do it in Houston, Texas. So, amazing moment for all of us. We fought hard for 4 years to do that.
That was the game where the run from God,
oh, yeah,
came, Cobb.
Yeah, I ran.
Cobb's
I broke five flat, and he thinks it's the run from God. So,
fourth and three on their 43, and Cobb takes it 43 yards. And we were on the sideline saying, that's a run from God. There's no way Cobb can do that and not get caught.
Exactly. Mostly that's what happened.
Yes.
So y'all probably don't know all of that. Some of you Stephenville guys do. But we may get to the start of the story that you know now. He takes the job at Baylor. Baylor program hasn't been to a bowl game, I think the video said, in 22 years. And it's a very similar situation as Stephenville when he got there, as Houston when he got there. And Art's going to come in and do what only Art does. He's going to rebuild the program. And you started to gain incredible momentum there. He lands RG3, who ended up winning the Heisman Trophy. What are some of the other things that happened that were just, I mean, almost beyond expectation sometime? Maybe not for you, but from the outside looking.
Yeah, I think, getting there was the first time I'd ever been to a private institution. And so trying to make Waco and Baylor feel as one. You know, when we got there, Baylor was this, little private school on the other side of town, and Waco was, Waco. And so bringing those two together was certainly important.
A huge stadium.
Yeah, when we first got there, they're giving tickets away, every weekend and covering up half the seats. But as we got there, when I got there and got to really seeing how it all, fit, I mean, you got to have a stadium on campus. I mean, that's something you have to have if you're going to be in my opinion, a major college and a player in the Big 12. And so, we worked through that and were able to win enough to get people excited enough to donate and make that happen. And really, that's probably the two or three biggest changes is getting a guy like RG3, who is actually committed to us at the University of Houston and came to Baylor.
I'm going to stop you there for just a minute. Yeah. So if RG3 would have come to Houston, if Art wouldn't have taken the Baylor job, it would have been me, Case Keenum, who's still playing, and RG3 would have been the three quarterbacks at the University of Houston. And I bet between all of us, we probably had, 15 scholarship offers between – RG3 probably had a bunch.
He had some as safety and wide receiver.
Okay.
He only had one at quarterback.
I had about five, and Case had one, and that was Art. And all three of us went to the NFL. So you can see that he can judge talent
There's a lot of things that make a champion. And, like you said earlier, it starts with the heart. And all three of those people have a tremendous heart, tremendous intelligence. I mean, you have – the thing I always look for at QBs are guys that were smart and that were passionate. And so that gives you a chance to have a great leader.
So championships, two-time Big 12 champion. If y'all didn't follow this, I'm sincerely saying this. This is what it was like from a national level. Bryles was as big or bigger than Baylor. In the football world, which I was living in, Bryles was world-renowned because of the innovation that they were doing. Nobody could stop them. Nick Saban himself is still scared of the Bryles offense. You start to push guys all over the country, Syracuse, Tulsa, they start to have success. The philosophy works, and the offense works. The Big 12 scared to death. Texas doesn't know what's about to happen. Oklahoma's scared up. You beat Oklahoma in the championship, right? In the Big 12 championship. And Coach wins Big 12, or the National Coach of the Year in 2012 or 13. You can say it. You won it. Yeah, you won the award.
Let me think about it.
2013. Yeah, 13, right. National Coach of the Year. National Coach of the Year. Program's top three, top five in the country, top two at one time. Everybody's scared of Baylor. And then suffering hit. Bad times hit. In your words, Coach, what ultimately happened? Without going into great detail, but what do you think? What happened?
Yeah, I think a lot of variables involved. Without a doubt, a lot of wrongs that you can never make right. You mentioned the Big 12s and the Coach of the Year, all that stuff. I mean, all that is completely irrelevant, as because it's all about, being a person of purpose and, a person that, can carry the name proudly. And so what's given me grace and given me hope and given me freedom is knowing that I have people that love me and care about me, and so I'm able to move on. I mean, they're just like a parent, there are some things that went on at the university that, I certainly feel responsible for. We all paid a dear price for it on earth, which is, once again, can be overcome, because the ultimate goal is to, end up in heaven. And so by how you live your life and how you live your faith determines what you get to do there. And so that's that's the thing that keeps me going. But I mean, as an institution, to answer your question, what went wrong? Many institutional failures that didn't protect students. You know, it cost the president, cost AD, cost me my job. And fortunately, you know, they've moved forward and done things that are in the right direction now, and everybody's benefiting from it at the university.
When that happened, obviously there's you can hear there's a level of I don't want to say guilt, but he blames himself a little bit, like any parent would blame themselves if their kid goes astray. Maybe you raised that kid perfectly in your mind and in the church. There's somebody out here today that your kid went astray. I've got four daughters. I fear it. He had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of sons. He was a surrogate father to hundreds of sons. And legally, he's innocent. But he carries a level of guilt and shame that brought us to a phone call. It's 6 months to a year after all this is going on. There's hope that he might get his job back. There's hope that that he can resurrect his career. And the Holy Spirit prompted me to make this phone call. Not an easy phone call. And I'll never forget it, and that's why we're here today. God gave it to me whenever I knew I was going to deliver the message today. And I said, Coach, how are you doing? And he said, Cobb, you really don't understand what it's like. You really don't understand what it's like to be here, to have your name crushed by everybody. And I said, Coach, your name is not Coach Art Browse. Not to me. Not to your friend, not to your brother. You're no longer my coach. You're my friend. And he said, he screamed it. And he didn't scream at me my entire college career. He screamed it at me. And he said, I have to redeem my name. I have to redeem my name. Kevin, you don't understand. I have to redeem my name. And I'll never forget this one. My grandkids have to wear this name. Didn't say I was innocent. Didn't say there weren't victims. He said, I have to redeem my name. The enemy had gotten a hold to him and told him that his name was not redeemed. And in the quietest voice I've ever come up with, I whispered to him, Coach, your name is redeemed. Not your earthly name, Coach, but your heavenly name, Art Browse, beloved son of God. Don't let the lies creep in. You have to remind yourself who you are. And I'm here to remind you that your name is redeemed eternally. I just got back from the Holy Land last week in Israel. And one thing that really came, it really settled in on me and my family is, that is our inheritance. That Holy Land is ours too. The eternal heaven and new earth is ours. I fear we don't focus on the inheritance of the kingdom. I fear that there's a lot of people in suffering that are sitting there questioning if their name is redeemed. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, then it doesn't matter what the enemy does. It doesn't matter what kind of sin you're in. It doesn't matter what the earth can do to you, what the world can do to you. This man went through a ton, as much as any man I've ever seen suffer during this time. And to hear your brother and your friend question if his name is redeemed because of what the world did to him broke my heart. I fear that there's people out here today that ask themselves the same question. It's maybe so dark in your world or somebody that you know that you forget that you're redeemed. You forget your inheritance. We should be celebrating our inheritance. The Bible says that the angels jump for joy and celebrate every time that a sinner repents of his sins. Just repentance, and repentance is a big deal. But we're talking about inheritance. Can you imagine if we walked through the world every single day and we were focused on the inheritance of the kingdom of heaven? Let's go to the Bible real quick, and I'm going to tell you what Romans 8:14 says. I'm speaking to myself right here. I struggle with this. I'm a very driven person. I should be jumping for joy every single day as an orphan before God chose me as his own. 8:14 says this, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. These are not my words. These are God's. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. But you received a spirit of adoption through which we cry, Abba, Father. If you've never gotten to a point where you kneel on the ground and you say, Abba, Father, thank you, thank you, thank you. I did it with my family in Israel. It's intimacy. It's an intimate God that you have a relationship with, and you know that you're going with him one day, and it's all going to be okay. You're focused on your inheritance in the kingdom of heaven. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, here it is, then you're heirs. You're heirs of God. And here's the crazy one. When you walk where Jesus walked, you're joint heirs with Christ. Do you believe it? Do you celebrate it every single day? Do you know that your name is redeemed? Do you remind yourself that your name is redeemed? Because if you do, just this small crowd right here can bring thousands more to the kingdom of heaven. And that's exactly what God's desire is. It's our job to celebrate it every single day, what Christ did for us, so that we can have an eternal life in heaven with God. Your name is redeemed. Coach, why an important part of this story?
I like it better when you preach, Kyle.
No, you're doing good.
No,
I'm passionate about this. I'm telling you, if you were there, if you could hear your mentor and your friend and your coach and somebody that helped me so long say, I got to redeem my name? It's a hard thing to go through. You guys know people in your life that's like that. Why is your name so important to you? Our names are important to anybody. Names are important to God. We know Abraham. We know Isaac. He chose Isaac. We know Jacob. He changed to Israel. Sarah. Names are important. I'm not saying names are not important, but I'm talking about eternal name over earthly name. That's our focus today, and it is redeemed if you're a believer in Christ.
You bet. That's really a good point, too. You know, because I've come to the comfort of knowing that you know, my name is redeemed in heaven. The earthly name, you know, you always want to carry a responsibility, you know, for someone, mm-hmm. you know, because everything you do for others. And
who carried it for you?
Well,
tough question.
Well, my mother and dad, you know, and they, you know, they tragically passed away when I was 20 years old. And, you know, so I've been trying to live ever since then my life for them, for their glory, you know, in heaven. So that's, you know, that's a feeling that I cherish and also feel a responsibility for, you know, on earth. And hopefully, you know, or not hopefully, I know that, you know, my son and daughters and grandchildren will feel the same way. So mm-hmm. Name is important. It's important, but you have to understand that people that know. I mean, just people that love you just like a parent unconditionally. You know, they're going to be with you when you need help. I mean, when you're doing okay, you know, it's not when you find out who loves you. When you're struggling and suffering, that's when you find the people that truly love you. And so I've been extremely blessed. You know, I've come to a place in my life to where, you know, just honestly, like I've always done, I've always tried to help other people fulfill their dreams. You know, you mentioned what was some good things that happened at Baylor. Some of my proudest moments ever were seeing first-generation graduates.
Yeah.
You know, at Houston and at Baylor. And that's because, to me, that's a huge deal to have a little girl or son look up at their daddy and say, hey, you know, you graduated from college. I can, too, if that's important in your life, you know.
And well, we have story after story. Donnie Avery comes to mind in this. Donnie Avery wanted to quit as a freshman. Coach talked him into sticking with it. He couldn't catch a cold. He was just blazing fast. Donnie, from the streets of Houston, stuck with us, was a 33rd overall pick, had an unbelievable NFL career, raises a great family. Now he's leaning into God. Now he's leaning into my life and saying, Kevin, help me with this. He's asked me about a mortgage. He's asked me about how do you take family trips. My parents actually got to take him on a family trip last summer, because he didn't know what it's like for a parent. But it all starts with coach not letting him quit. You know what I mean? Like, that's the type of stories that come, and that's your proudest moments of what you're talking about.
100%.
Along with those, though, come incredible suffering. And some of y'all may know about the suffering. Some of you may not know how deep it really was and still is, and how hard it is for what Coach went through. But when I was in Israel, and when I was thinking about art, I was thinking like, man, it almost got to a point where it got past the truth, and it got to a point of mockery. Sound familiar? If you read your Bible, it sounds familiar. It got to a point of mockery, and that's whenever all types of emotions, as a family and as a brother in Christ, you want to reach out and you want to do more. We were sitting in the tabernacle in Nazareth, and Jesus had just gotten back from the wilderness. We're sitting there with my family. We're sitting there with a group from our church. Picture this. It's amazing. Some of y'all have been there. And the story's told in the Bible that Jesus comes back from the wilderness. He goes through Galilee. He starts to perform some miracles. And he gets there, and it's his home synagogue. It's his own people. It's probably his uncle, his cousin. He probably studied in that desk. Picture it. It is somber when you're there and you realize what happened. He was there to rescue his own people. He was there to rescue his family, his cousins, his childhood friends. And he rolls out Isaiah 61, the scribe, and he reads it. And he fulfills the prophecy, and he says, I am the Messiah. It is me. I'm here to save you. You need a savior, and I'm here to save you. I am God. You know what they did? They ushered him to the edge of the cliff. We walked it. I've seen it. They walked him to the edge of the cliff, and they tried to kill him because their tradition and their religion and their institution meant more than Jesus Christ himself, a savior, and he was there for him. They tried to kill him. In the same place, my 10-year-old daughter is there. She got saved 6 months ago. I told her I was bringing her up on stage, but I was just kidding. And she says, Daddy, I want to get baptized where Jesus got baptized. Can I be baptized in the Sea of Galilee? Which we know it's the Jordan, but it was a long story. We go to the Sea of Galilee. Guys, we're trying to teach our kids that there's real suffering when you follow Christ. The enemy is real. My daughter walks out in the water, and I'm standing on this side of her. Pastor Joey's standing on this side, and all of her family is around her, church family and family. And I'm praying over her, and we're about to baptize her. We're asking her some strategic questions. And a crowd starts to gather, just like the mob gathered, just like the mob gathered with Jesus. Here they come after my 10-year-old daughter. And they're not celebrating. They come up close, and all the eyes start to turn to us. And this group of boys, these teenage boys, and some other ones, they get about 10 feet from us. And the old Kevin wanted to turn around and dunk them, baptize them themselves, but I didn't do that. And Joey just said, hey, this is exactly what it's supposed to look like. And they're saying, Jesus isn't for real. You're mistaken. My wife's trying to explain Jesus to him. Did you know over there you can't explain Jesus to them if they're under a certain age? We didn't know that. We were about to get in legal trouble by spreading Jesus. And they start dunking each other and laughing and mocking my 10-year-old daughter. We go through with the baptism, and I pull her aside later in front of the family, and I said, hey, what was going through your head when that moment happened? And she said, Daddy, I knew I was doing the right thing, and all y'all were there with me. See, she had people to remind her right there in that moment when it was kind of weird for a 10-year-old. Like, man, am I doing the right thing? This isn't my land. I don't know if I'm supposed to be here. These guys seem pretty confident that their tradition is more important than our Messiah. And she said, nope. I knew I was doing what was right, and you were there with me. I guarantee you, if you ask this man what brought him back to the place he's at today, which, by the way, is the best version of Art Briles I've ever seen in my life, and I've seen some really good versions. I declare that sincerely. It's because he had a family and a community to remind him who he was when the noise was cranked up too loud and the darkness was too heavy He couldn't even believe that his name was redeemed. He couldn't even go to the grocery store, right? Didn't want to go out. Had to talk him into playing golf again. Your community and your family and the people that you surround yourself with have to remind you in the darkest times who you are. Here's the part of the story you don't know. You were that for me. In 2013, when I came back home from the NFL, I was a broken, broken man. And unfortunately, I led my wife to a broken, broken woman. And I walked in the doors of Stonewater, and this leadership and this church got us back to a place of health. They weren't concerned about my stature, my career, our money. They were concerned about my broken heart. And I dove into this church, and it's why I'm up here today, because you guys nursed me back to health. I was saved at 16, but I was broken. Guys, you have to surround yourself with community, the right community that will take the step to make the phone call like I made to Art during that time. It was not a fun place to be as his mentee. I didn't want to do it. It was uncomfortable to call my coach. You don't know how much you're supposed to talk. Does he really want to just stay quiet? Does he not want to talk about it all? But prompted by the Holy Spirit, I made a really tough phone call. Who is your community? That's my challenge. Do you have the people that'll make the hard phone call? Do you have the people that love you dearly and remind you who you are in Christ? Because we're all going to suffer at some point. If you don't, you better get it. Because you don't want to be where this man was and not have it. It's too late. I've got one more person that I want to come out and remind you who you are. Let's see if he's here.
Is it Ernest?
It's not Ernest.
Thank goodness.
This is Kendall Bryles. This is his son. Kendall still wears the name. Still goes through the suffering. Very similar to what Art went through. And Kendall's there to remind his dad that he's a dad and a grandpa and the beloved son of Christ. And I'm going to be there forever for you, going through what you go through. I send Kendall scripture multiple times throughout the week during the season because I know how hard it is for him. I want him to be reminded he's not Coach Kendall Bryles. I want him to always be rooted in Christ. We have to have our community. We have to recognize ourselves as redeemed children of God, if you are, and we have to celebrate it daily together. And if we do, we walk out just like this.
At halftime, things looked grim for Coach Art Bryles and his team. They were down 17-14 as history seemed destined to repeat itself. But something happened on the field that night in Texas, something that would change the town of Stephenville forever.
Hey, give God a hand this morning. One, I'm just proud and honored of Kevin and that he is a part of our family. And God just used you to use this place to minister to him and the opportunity to minister to Coach Briles and his family too. So thankful that those guys would share with us this morning. Here's the question for you today. Are you redeemed? Like, what does that mean to be redeemed? It means that you've put your faith in Jesus Christ, that you know that there is no other way on earth or in heaven to be right with God, that there is something that has separated you from God at sin, and because of his son Jesus and what he did on the cross, if we put our faith in him, we are redeemed. And we're redeemed such that we can experience heaven, just as you heard Coach Briles talk about, that we could experience heaven one day, but I want to tell you that there's heaven on earth. That walking with Jesus each and every day is just a reminder of the redemption that we have, and we experience God here, day in and day out. Are you redeemed? Don't leave this place today without asking that question. And if the answer is not yes, if the answer is I'm not sure, if the answer is I don't even know what this guy's talking about, before you leave this place, there's some tables that are right here at the corner of the room. I encourage you just to swing by and just stand there. For some reason, if you could have just a few seconds of courage to ask the question, hey, I want to know what it looks like to be redeemed. And then if you're someone here that says, gosh, I thank you, Lord, that I'm redeemed. I thank you that you have saved me. I thank you that you are my King, my Lord, my Savior. I pray you celebrate that, just as Kevin shared, that we celebrate the inheritance that we have in Christ in a life today. Don't walk out these doors. Don't walk through the week. Don't walk through your life as you engage with your family and not remember what God has given you today. And the last thing that you heard Kevin talk about is community. You can't do this alone. We don't walk out our inheritance. We don't walk out a life of redemption without having people around us, because there are days when it's going to get dark. And it's going to get quiet, and the enemy is going to come against you. People are going to come against you. This world is broken, and you're going to have to walk in it day in and day out. And you need people around you who are going to remind you of the redemption that you found in Jesus Christ. I encourage you guys, this is a family, and we want to be your family. If you're walking alone, I encourage you, stop at these tables. Stop at the Connection Center. Let us help find you people who want to walk right along with you. Men, it's just a special challenge. This is a service for you today. I don't care if you're a football fan or not. What a great day if you're a man to just sit and listen to what it looks like to be challenged and encouraged. Next week, we have a man event. July 30th, we have a man event. You're going to have men out front who are handing you cards about this. Man, what an amazing first step you could take to find community. Guys, we love you. Remember that you are redeemed, that you have an inheritance that we are to celebrate, and you can't walk this out alone. We love you. Go and be redeemed.